it because he already has the water energy and the Frogadier, but it could be that he actually just doesn't have a supporter, which would could end badly.
And there is something very important going on with Pedro here, because of course he is by far the underdog in this particular game. Ability lock comes in from Greninja, which is very big because of Volcanion Steam Up ability, and he's being hit for weakness all the way along. Pedro is going to want a very big turn here. A couple of Steam Ups and an attack from a non-EX Volcanion can give him a first turn knockout on Froakie, really put the pressure on, put Drew on a little bit of a clock, and he's already gone and got a Hooper, used Hooper's ability, which allows him to search for any free EXs, and to the surprise of, I think, nobody, he's gone for two Volcanion EXs and a Shaman to draw more cards.
Yeah, this is pretty much the standard free search that you normally do off of a Hooper Scoundrel Ring when you're playing this Volcanion deck. You just want to get your Volcanions out as soon as possible, because of course the more of them you have out, the more chances you have to do Steam Up and really start racking up that damage that you can do, and obviously with the Shaman letting you draw more cards as well. And we can see there one Steam Up already from Pedro, so he's going to use a... That's really nice of him. He's going to use a die to sort of help count the number that he's actually done.
Helps out a lot for us. Now, one thing which is very, very interesting here, Pedro actually plays two Float Stones, and we've already seen that they are both prized, which means, now he has got an Escape Rope in hand, but if he wants to attack with the non-EX Volcanion, he is going to need to get that Volcanion EX out of the active. So it's absolutely vital that he's got a Shaman in hand, we all know that, he dragged it out with the Hooper. He is going to need to grab a non-EX Volcanion so that he can escape rope into that. He needs to get an attack off this turn. It needs to happen. He needs to start taking prizes as soon as he possibly can.
Yeah, and chances are good with him here, because he has been able to play enough cards to do setup to draw five of the Shaman, but is he going to see it? It doesn't look like he has. He hasn't got a trainer's mail, so obviously if he sees an Ultra Ball off of that, then that would be able to find him the Volcanion he needs, but it will come down to whether he finds this Ultra Ball.
He has got a couple of supporters he can throw away with Ultra Ball, so that would be a good time. And that's almost like a little bit of an insult from his deck there. There was a non-EX Volcanion in the trainer's mail, but all he got to do was a Max Elixir. Now, here's an interesting little play. He's actually now going to use his second Max Elixir. If he hits that, he can actually manually attach the energy in his hand, play the escape rope, and KO the Froakie on the bench using Volcanic Heat.
A turn one Volcanic Heat is not something you see every day, Ross.
I would be surprised if he'd... And as an extra bonus, just in case that wasn't fun enough, he's going to avoid the Bursting Balloon by knocking out the benched Froakie. So that's got to be the play here, I believe.
It comes up time and time again, Ross. You see in these matches where, you know, you compare Switch to Escape Rope and you know, how they function. Escape Rope, just almost every single time at these high-level tables, you see it over, because it just offers you that versatility. Most of the time when you want to switch, it ends up working out so that you're pushing something else annoying active out of the way as well. And because of that, it just makes Escape Rope incredible. And we see that to full effect here because, of course, as you said, the Bursting Balloon, Froakie's going to go to the bench and he's going to be able to switch at the same time. Such a great play.
Really, really good play. Now, I'm going to be honest, I didn't see this happening at the beginning of the turn. I didn't think this was going to be possible, but there we go, ladies and gentlemen. Third energy, Volcanic Heat for 130 damage. It's a little bit too much to KO a Froakie, but I don't think Pedro is complaining.
Actually, there was one Steam Up done, and it's a Fighting Fury Belt, so it was 170 damage, so even more overkill.
And actually, that would be enough to KO a Greninja Break.
Indeed,
now,
it would.
That's going to be very important as we go along, because 130 from Volcanic Heat will be enough to get a one-hit KO on a Greninja, but for a Greninja Break, we need either two Steam Ups or a Steam Up with a Fighting Fury Belt. So using that Shadow Stitching to turn off abilities is going to be absolutely crucial, but of course, we can't really talk about using Shadow Stitching to turn off abilities until Drew actually get some Greninja going here.
Yeah, and right now, a very unfortunate situation for Drew. We saw him Super Rod the Froakie that just got knocked out back into the deck, and then use a Dive Ball to sort of search for it straight away, but then looking through the rest of his deck to see what's actually in there, but has he actually got anything else?
And he had to do this. He could not have gone for a Frogadier there because he didn't have the energy, which means he couldn't use Water Duplicates, which means a KO from Pedro on that Frogadier would have ended the game right there. An energy would have meant Dive Ball for Frogadier, Water Energy Duplicates, could not have done it due to the lack of energy. So as annoying as that turn was, that's all Drew could do.
Yeah, it's so unfortunate when it happens. We saw it happen sort of earlier on in the stream as well. And this is one of the weaknesses of the Greninja deck, is that sometimes it can just, as the common phrase goes, lose to itself. It's because you know it's a deck that plays no shame in, and obviously that is also an advantage because it means that all the stuff being knocked out is only worth one prize. It means that you don't have that same amount of searchable outs to a hand which isn't doing much for you, and we're seeing an example of that right here.
We are indeed. Now, this is Pedro's route to winning the game. Now, he's got the Skyfield down. We see there he's filling up his bench. This is how Pedro wins the game. He's got to rush Drew. If this game develops and both decks set up, Drew is going to win this game. He's got a huge advantage with hitting for weakness and with the ability lock. But if Pedro can just keep knocking out Pokemon, keep taking prizes, and Drew never sets up, and you've already said yourself, Nick, that actually this is a deck that can fail to set up sometimes, that is Pedro's route to victory. Now, I see that N going down from the Ultra Ball. If I'm Pedro, I don't play that N.
Yeah, absolutely not. If he plays that N, he's just giving Drew essentially six new cards to work with to be able to draw out this, whereas as it stands right now, Drew will basically have his draw for turn, and if that's not something useful, we'll be moving straight on to game two.
Absolutely, and that is, it's a big thing. And Drew, we've seen comebacks. We have seen big comebacks from these Greninja decks. We've had a few on stream this weekend. We've seen some big comebacks, but it's much, much harder when there are Pokemon hitting for 130. Yes, Drew's hitting for weakness. Yes, Drew turns off that Steam Up ability, which very well timed there. Pedro just used Steam Up as I said that. But as we go along here, if Pedro doesn't have the break, then... Excuse me, if Drew doesn't have the break, Pedro will be getting easy one-hit KOs with Volcanic Heat every single turn. And that means that the ability lock is going to be irrelevant.
Yeah, absolutely, because we saw turn one Volcanic Heat, double Max Elixir. You don't see it very often, but I mean, here it is now, and it's just so much pressure so early on. The Greninja deck, when it's put under this much early pressure and things are just being KO'd left, right, and center, even though it is the comeback deck, sometimes... when it comes to developing into a situation like this, it is still too much even for a deck like Greninja to come back from.
And you see Pedro there playing the Max Elixir now. He chose to put it on one of his benched Volcanion EXs, and that's a very, very good play. Yes, it's an EX. Yes, it's weak to Drew's deck. Yeah, it gives up two prizes, but it allows the one-hit KOs on Greninja, and that's got to be what Pedro's thinking. Pedro cannot play conservatively in this matchup. That is a big retreat there. Got to be done, of course.
Yeah, it is. But it's also really clever because, of course, he's already done a Steam Up this turn. So that means that with the Fighting Fury Belt, that's a Volcanic... The Power Heater attack is going to do 60 damage, which will knock out the Froakie and allow him to attach those two energies again. So really, really clever.
Really, really clever. And, of course, he couldn't have used the Volcanion EX attack there because... you can only use it once, and then you can't use it the next turn. Now, you could play a Pokemon Ranger to turn that off, but clearly Pedro didn't have, and there we go.
So Drew obviously just drew past there, and then, yeah, Pedro had the energy in hand with the Steam Up. So, yeah, that's it. Moving on to game two.
Pedro knocks out three Froakies in three turns and goes up 1-0 on Drew in this crucial final round matchup. And you see Pedro there just apologizing, saying, you know, I'm really sorry. I know that wasn't a very competitive game. I'm sorry to win, lad. We've all been there. We've all won games, which frankly we won because our opponent drew nothing. But when you're in the win and in game for the top eight of the first ever European International Championship, and you get the opportunity to go one game up, if I'm Pedro, I don't mind how I win.
Yep, I think, as they say, a lot of players end up saying, we take those.
We do take those. What I do like, though, brilliant show of sportsmanship. I love this community and how friendly and lovely everybody is. And just a really nice example there, you know, being on stream, you beat your opponent, and then immediately, the first thing Pedro does, you see a nice friendly conversation where he says, you know, I'm sorry I had to win like that. That's very, very nice.
Yeah, it's really nice to see that in a competitive game, especially when you consider what these two players are playing for. There is so much on the line here, yet still, this is a very, very high-stakes game, you know. Like I said, it's just great sportsmanship, and it's a really great example to anyone, really.
No, it really, really is. It really, really is. Now, here we're going to see Drew going first again. We assume he's going to choose to go first. And he's going to hope for a better setup. Now, I was thinking about the Talonflame, because obviously Drew didn't start Talonflame last game. He was very, very close. I think it might have been the eighth card in his hand, but that is, of course, irrelevant. But even if he had started the Talonflame, it still would have been one-hit KO'd by the Volcanion EX, and he still wouldn't have had the energy to use water duplicates. So the game wouldn't have actually mattered there. Of course, he also wouldn't have had the energy to use Aero Blitz. So if Drew just can get an energy here, maybe start the Talon Flame, get a couple of Froakies out turn one, could be different. So here we go in round two, game two, and he does start the Talon Flame. So this is a big, big difference here. Hopefully he's going to have some basic energy, get a couple of Froakies on the bench. And oh, we do see that one Frogadier is prized from Drew here, but you can still get three Frogadiers out, so it's not the worst thing ever, but certainly it's going to help Pedro. The fewer Frogadiers Drew has, the easier route Pedro has to knocking all of them out.
Yes, and we do see there as well that Drew does have the dive ball in his opening hand, so sometimes the problem can be, especially when you go first and start Talonflame, if you don't have a Froakie as well with it, or a dive ball or a level ball to search for one, then that means that you have to wait another turn before you can evolve into Greninja, but that's not happening at all here. So yeah, Drew pretty much getting the ideal turn one, Talonflame active, two Froakies on the bench, so brilliant start from Drew there.
Yeah, he's going to want to evolve to Frogadier next turn, of course, and either he can Aero Blitz or he can evolve to the Frogadier and then use that Water Duplicates attack. So we do see a Max Elixir coming down here and another hit on the Max Elixir. According to David, our resident statistician, if you're playing, you know, 11 or 12 energy, Pedro is playing 12, you should hit three of the four, assuming you're playing a full complement of four like Pedro is. So Pedro doing quite well with those Max Elixirs.
You know, it's funny, you mentioned, oh, we've got a Floatstone active as well. You mentioned about how your Volcanic Heat on the Volcano and EX can actually knock out a Talonflame. Are we going to see that?
I mean, quite possibly. I mean, if you're Drew, that's got to be the worry here. You've just sat and watched Pedro get a double Max Elixir, manual attachment KO on turn one, and really just that really led to him losing the game. You don't want to see that again, because the problem is those Froakies do not stand up against Volcanion. One Steam Up, Fighting Fury, about 60 damage, and you get to attach two energy while you do so. That is not what Drew wants to see here.
Definitely not. And we see that Pedro drawing the Hooper off the Sycamore being really huge as well. He can use that to search for two more Volcanions and a Shaman. He can then use those two Volcanions to empty out the rest of the fire energies he's drawn out of his hand, then attach one to the Volcanion EX and do a Shaman setup for a load of cards, which means that he's pretty likely to hit another Max Elixir.
He is. Now, there is a more conservative route here, and it really is up to Pedro how aggressive he wants to feel, because he can attach an energy to Volcanion and then just use Power Heater and take, you know, well, at the moment it would be 50 damage, but depends how many Steam Ups he uses. That is an option. Now, he could, and this is a lot to ask, four Steam Ups and Power Heater for 140. It is possible. If he's got, no, he has got a Volcanion EX price, so it is not possible. So does he want to chip away with some damage and get some energy on the field, or does he just want to go for the big KO with Max Elixir here?
We're going to find out the answer right now, depending on where this fire engine goes down. Ooh, he's... Okay, he's going the more conservative route, and this is absolutely fine as well. Still, you know, he's still doing a lot of damage with Power Heater. He's going to get the energies onto two of his Volcanion EXs. It's an absolutely fine route to take.
He is going to be upset if he hits a Max Elixir here. Now, I don't see one in his hand, so he's made the right choice. And we see this in the Pokemon trading card game so often. There are two decisions, and we just saw one there. Do I try the Power Heater, or do I go all out for the big attack and the KO? There is a right answer, but you have no way of knowing it. Oh, my goodness. Now that he's drawn the escape rope, he has definitely made the right choice. All he needs to do is one more Steam Up, and we know he's got the Pokemon in play to do that. He'll be using Power Heater for 80, he'll get a KO, and because he's used a couple of Power Heaters, he then gets to attach two of those energy from his discard to two of his benched Pokemon.
He's actually already done enough Steam Ups to do it, because earlier before he played down Shaman, he had like three or four Fire Engine in his hand, so he already did enough Steam Ups to get a knockout, so there it is.
He's actually done three. The handy dice is coming out there, so Power Heater for 110 damage. That is a little bit upsetting for Drew, and there must be a little bit of deja vu going on here. Now, he's got the energy, he's got a Frogadier. If I'm Drew, you've got to do it here. You can't take the chance with Talonflame. It's too slow. You've got a Water Duplicate. Now, he is about to find out that one of those is prized, if he doesn't know already. And that Frogadier is going to be KO'd by a Volcanion EX next turn. But that still means he's got two Frogadiers on the bench, and then he can start attacking and getting rid of those abilities and start kind of mounting the comeback, which we all know Greninja can do in this game.
Yeah, and absolutely at this point, Drew has set up early enough to the point where it's far from insurmountable, especially considering the inherent advantage that he has over Pedro Zek if he does get set up. I fancy Drew's chances here.
He's doing very well. Now, if Pedro could hit one more Max Elixir, I'm feeling really good about his chances. And the reason is very simply because if he's got an energy in hand, which he's going to be end, he's going to draw five cards here, but we assume he's going to draw an energy. He's playing 12 of them. So if he draws an energy here, then all he needs to do is retreat the Volcano and he's got the KO on the Frogadier next turn, or maybe even he can use double steam up and get the KO using Power Heater, which obviously would be his preferred route.
And he has already discarded one energy for steam up as well. Again, that die coming in handy.
So now if he gets an energy, he can just go ahead and use that. And then he's got two Volcanian EXs essentially set up. Oh, there's no energy there.
But there is a Max Elixir.
Which means if he wants to KO, he's going to have to use Volcanian EX. And that was a big N there.
Yeah, it really was. And we see that he's going to play the Ultra Balls, and he's actually discarding the Max Elixir. So I guess what he's going for here is he has that Skyfield in his hand. So he's probably going to search a second shame and play the Skyfield and then do a setup and just try to hit the energy.
And I think this is a good play here. I really like this play because he really wants to use Power Heater. Drew is not going to win by knocking out loads of Baby Volcanians. He's going to win by knocking out the EXs. That Baby Volcanian, a non-EX Volcanian, is really not all that... It's not that much of a worry at the moment. Pedro wants to use Power Heater. He wants to get the energy out. His route to winning is free energy Volcanians knocking out Greninjas. And getting a KO with Power Heater does that. Although, did he draw an energy off
no,
that?
No, he drew another Max Elixir and a Trainer's Mail, but no energy. Very unlucky.
That is very unlucky. Now, he's still got the option of the Volcanian EX here. Oh, and would you believe it? Of course there's an energy of the Trainer's Mail.
It's always the way, isn't it? So, yeah, he's got a... Yeah, see that scratching his head a little bit, but thinking, why couldn't that have been the other way around? Like, you know. But, yeah, he's got a decision here to take. Looks like he's going to take the Olympia off of that. So, Olympia being a supporter that we see every now and then, it's a really cool, a reusable switching tool, of course. When you play it, it gets a switcher active of a bench Pokemon, and you heal 30 damage off of the Pokemon that just went to the bench.
You do, and it's a brilliant card. I've used it myself in a few decks. It is. It's a nice little niche one-off supporter that you reuse with Versus Seeker. Now, one thing that's going in Pedro's favour here is that Drew cannot actually one-hit a Volcanion EX without using an ability. Greninja maxes out at 80 damage, Moonlight Slash returning the energy to your hand, which doubles to 160, and he's not playing any extra cards which kind of up the damage like Giovanni's scheme. Now, he can use Greninja Break's ability, but he's not going to have a Greninja Break next turn. Of course, he could hit for 160, and then on his next turn, use a Greninja Break's Giant Water Shuriken to get a KO mid-turn. So Pedro does not want to attack with a Volcanion EX, but he's got the third energy, and it's what we've been saying all game. He cannot afford to sit and wait and see what happens. He's got to go aggressively. And actually, that Bursting Balloon means he will be in range from a Greninja here.
Yeah, and it's unfortunate for him, but yeah, like you said, if you... I mean, the Greninja deck can come back enough as it is. If you let them get a prize lead on you, then really you're just not going to be doing much of anything because every single time you take a knockout against Greninja, you know you're only drawing one prize card, whereas that's not the case for them. You know that they have the potential to easily take, you know, two prize knockouts off of all your stuff. So it's really, really on Pedro to make sure that he's taking a prize every single turn.
And he draws a dive ball and an energy off that Ace Trainer. And an Ultra Ball as well, actually. Oh, and that's really nice. Getting rid of Faded Town, which does nothing in this matchup, and a Talonflame, which he can only use as his active Pokemon at the beginning of the game. That might be the best Ultra Ball discard I've ever seen. As weird as that sounds to say out loud.
Or at least close to it, yeah. And we see there are two Greninjas coming down as well, so even if Pedro manages to get the knockout on one of the Greninjas, there will be at least a potential for one Greninja break next turn from Drew, and that's really the point where, if you're Pedro, you're looking, you're staring down at that and you're thinking to yourself, that's a lot of damage coming my way.
And I think Drew is really moving into the driver's seat here. Now, I've said that ordinarily a Greninja cannot one-hit KO a Volcanion EX, and that's still true. But of course, if they've already got six damage counters from a Bursting Balloon, like we're about to see here, then you can one-hit KO a Volcanion EX, essentially. And if you've got an ability, the Giant Water Shuriken, and you use that, then you can KO with just a single attack. And that's what makes Drew such a favourite here. Now, it is a little bit sad that he wasn't able to get the KO with shadow stitching to turn off those steam ups. But if we look at Pedro's side of the field, one energy on the non-EX Volcanion, one energy on the EX, and he's already used a bunch of max elixirs, he might be forced to just power heater here.
Yeah, which would be a little bit awkward for him. Obviously, the ideal for him would be to just attach to this Volcanion EX and then use a Max Elixir to keep up that sort of race of prizes that we talk about, because if he does get knocked out in this Greninja, then although Akeley said earlier that getting out of the Greninja break would be the start of Drew being able to really flood the field with damage, at the same time, there's no backup Greninja for Drew at all. Drew only has a Froakie left, so he'll have to rely on that one Greninja break to see him through until he can maybe super rod some of his other Greninja lines back in and start setting up more on the bench.
Indeed, and that's crucial here, quite frankly. A KO here, and I don't really think it's on the cards, a KO here would be absolutely crucial. I mean, he would need to get the KO with Power Heater, where we would be looking at the full four steam ups, and he's still got a Volcanion EX prize, and he's got one in his discard. So we're really looking at a maximum of 80 damage here. Now, I believe he's got at least one Max Elixir left in his deck. Mm-hmm. So if he can hit the Max Elixir from this Sycamore, and then he can play it and hit an energy using the Max Elixir, then he would be able to get the energy and the KO. But it doesn't look like... Now, he's got a Scorched Earth, so he could play the Scorched Earth and then use Scorched Earth to discard an energy and draw two cards. Maybe that would work? Maybe he could draw into the Max Elixir that way?
And as you see, he's just checking his deck now, and he's just thinning it out. So the Max Elixir is in there. But, I mean, there's only one left. You're only drawing two cards out of a... We're not exactly sure how many cards are in the deck, but it's not exactly, a almost nothing deck. There's still quite a few, but it looks like that's what he's going to go for.
That's exactly what he's doing. Energy and energy. Oh, that's a little bit... It's kind of like, I really want a Max Elixir for an energy, and your deck's like, I tell you what, have two energy.
Yeah, just not really working out there for Pedro, unfortunately. So he's probably going to have to be content with, as you said, a power heater, but not for a knockout. He's going to be doing... He's not done any steam-ups yet either, so I'm not even sure if... I mean, you could do some. Looks like he's going to go for one at least, but whether he's going to go for two is another matter, because he probably wants to save some energy so that he maybe, if he needs to steam up later, then he can do. At the same time... Yeah, it's a little bit of a tricky situation for Pedro right now, and now he's going to go for the power heater, so he's going to be able to do 50 damage with that, and he needs to just decide what he wants to put this energy on. I'd imagine it will likely be the two Volcanion EXs, and yeah, that's exactly what's going to happen.
I believe so. We've seen a little bit of a shift from these Greninja decks in the past around a month or so. People have started playing Lysander in Greninja. Now, a few months ago, this was a rare inclusion. Nowadays, I believe every Greninja we've had on stream today has played Lysander. So, Drew no longer has to wait for those Volcanions to become active, and Pedro knows this. Drew is just going to Lysander and KO those Volcanion EXs. Pedro might as well get as much mileage out of them as he can, but you said yourself, Nick, this Greninja deck is not really built to jump ahead in prizes and win. It's built for the comeback. When it does jump ahead in prizes, it really does take advantage of that. Here comes the Greninja break. Here we see the Giant Water Shuriken onto the benched Volcanion EX, which not only now puts it in range of, a Moonlight Slash, but it actually negates the Fighting Fury Bout and still puts it in range of a Moonlight Slash. So it is not looking good for Pedro here at all. And we even see a Splash Energy coming down there. So if Pedro does get the KO on that Greninja break, all the Greninja break, the Froakie, all of that goes straight back into Drew's hand.
Yeah, it's really not an ideal situation at all, was it? For Pedro, rather. So Drew there going for the Professor Sycamore. It's interesting to see whether, because if he decides to keep the Splash Energy on the Greninja break so that he actually gets the effect of it, then he won't be able to knock out this Volcanion in the active, because he'll be capped at 60 damage, double for weakness, 120. But seeing as he has another Greninja break on the bench now, I guess he doesn't really need to keep the Splash Energy on the active?
I don't think Drew needs a KO here. If you think about Drew's route to winning, it's knocking out three EXs. He's already knocked out one. If he knocks out a Volcanion, it doesn't really get him any closer to winning. He's playing a seven-prize game, because he'll be taking five prizes and then have to KO an EX to take the final two and end up taking seven. Yeah. If I was Drew here, I would be prioritising keeping my Greninjas on the field rather than taking a knockout on that non-EX Volcanion. And it looks like that's what he's doing here. I would rather not get the KO. Oh, he's shadow stitching.
Yeah, I mean, if you're not going to get the KO, then doing it with the shadow stitching makes the most sense, because, of course, now Pedro will be unable to use Steam Up at all, and this means that it's going to just be even more insurmountable for him to actually make a comeback against these Greninja Breaks, which now have 170 HP, and he has no way of being able to knock out unless he plays a Pokemon Ranger.
And that would be the only thing he could do here. He could play a Pokemon Ranger, which would turn off the effect of Greninja's attack, which would then turn back on the abilities, because without a Steam Up, oh, and there is a Versus Seeker for a Pokemon Ranger, turning off the effect of Shadow Stitching, turning on his abilities, there's a Steam Up, and now he can hit for 170 damage and get the KO on that Greninja Break.
Right on the nose, 170 is exactly enough to get the knockout, and so really great. I mean, and even then, it's still not that bad for Drew, because he did the Shadow Stitching instead. Of course, that Splash Energy stayed on. He's going to get that whole Greninja line back to his hand. And obviously, it's a good turn for Pedro, but even then, it just barely even puts Drew back, which is incredible to think about.
And when you look at Drew's turn here, what's he going to do? He's going to use Moonlight Slash. He's going to get a KO. He's going to take two prizes. He's going to go down to two prizes remaining. And then we look over at Pedro's side of the board, and he's got a Volcanion EX with one energy and a Volcanion with one energy. Well, that, even with his abilities turned on, he is not threatening a KO. He's going to have to find and hit his final Max Elixir and attach from his hand, and he does not currently have an energy in hand, in order to get a KO next turn. Oh, and by the way, he'll need a second energy in hand in order to actually use the Steam Up. I do not like Pedro's chances of KOing this Greninja Break next turn, even with his abilities remaining on.
Yeah, neither do I. And we see there that, well, I mean, Drew's just, I'm not sure what he's doing in this. Oh, he's eyeing up a Lysander, so maybe he's thinking to himself that he might want to pick off something else. I'm not entirely sure, but I think it probably makes the most sense just to KO the active at this point.
I would be happy KO. I mean, I think you have to KO the active here, because that's the only Pokemon with enough energy on to really pose a threat. Now, this, however, I do like. He can't play the Ace Trainer because he's ahead on prizes.
No, he's not. He's got four prizes left to Pedro
3. Oh, I do apologise. I made that mistake in a league challenge once. I got a game loss for it. It was very, very silly. I was reading it as prizes taken, not prizes. I was reading it the wrong way round. No. He is behind by one prize, and I love the Ace Trainer play here. Thank you for the correction, Nick. That was very nice of you.
Oh, Ross.
So he plays the Ace Trainer here. He then goes and gets six cards. He puts Pedro down to three cards. Now, this could actually be an advantage, because Pedro needs an energy to attach, an energy to steam up, and a Max Elixir, and he had none of them in his previous hand.
No, he hadn't. Although, having said that, Drew's pretty much guaranteed himself a knockout here. You see, he has a basic water to do another giant water shuriken, and a bursting balloon to attach to the active Greninja as well. So, a stonker of a turn from Drew there.
And I think that might, and now Drew couldn't play an Ace Trainer.
Yes.
See, I'm learning. I think Drew has almost got this game. Because all he needs to do here is just evolve into a Greninja, attach an energy, and then he's got enough to KO that Volcanion EX on the bench. At which point, Pedro can't attack with a Volcanion EX, which is the only attacker that stands any chance of one-hit KOing a Greninja. So Pedro can't attack with the only thing he can use to win, because the only thing he can use to win will lead to a loss. It's not a good position in which to be.
It's a little bit of a catch-22.
I think this might be the very definition of a catch-22. There is nothing he can really do here. Now, the good news is that the first game was very, very short, so we will have enough time for a nice competitive game three. And I'd say I don't see any real way back for Pedro here, so it does mean that we're probably, by the time this game finishes up, they shuffle up, we should have about 15 minutes. That will be as add plus three turns, of course, which should be enough time to get a proper game free. Of course, we see how this is going. Pedro is going to win if he can get going nice and early. Drew, well, if the game goes on, this happens. Now, it really comes down to what's in Drew's hand at this point.
Yeah, and we see there Pedro playing an escape rope, so obviously Drew's just going to promote the Talonflame there. It's got free retreat, so it means he can decide. If he really wants to, he can promote Frogadier next turn, but I don't think he will somehow. But also, equally, it does get the Bursting Balloon out of the way as well, and it enables Pedro to promote the Volcanion, non-EX, and he's going to see there. Versus for an N, played out, is going to put Drew down to a two-card hand, and maybe Drew misses an energy at this point. I think it's the best Pedro can hope for, really, at this state in the game.
And missing an energy could be big. Now, of course, Pedro does really not have many kind of options here because he's still not going to be KOing anything. So Drew doesn't have one turn to find an energy. He's got at least two. Oh, speaking of energy, there's two splash energy. That's quite good.
Yes, there is. There's, I mean, it's energy, you know. It's not water, but it'll do.
Now, there is a scenario here, and it is a bit of a long shot, but Pedro's going to put an energy on his Greninja, his Volcanion EX here, which means one more energy, plus a Lysander, plus a Steam Up, and there is game.
Yeah, Drew drawing a Lysander off the top of the deck. He had the energy in hand, so Drew's going to take game two, and we are moving on to game three.
That was very, very nice. Now, what I was thinking there was a chance that he could use a Lysander to KO the Greninja break on the bench using a single Steam Up, and maybe Drew doesn't draw into the Greninja and the energy at the same time, but of course, complete moot point, and this is what we would expect to see happen. And again, I just love seeing these players. They're cheery, they're smiley, they're friendly, they're just kind of having a casual chat between games. You know, hey, how's it going? You know, the winner of this gets into top eight and plays for a guaranteed world invite if we make the final. You know, if we win the final, it's a very surreal thing. It's a very high pressure game. They're playing on Steam, and they're just having a nice chat.
Yeah, it's. I think a lot of the people in the Pokemon community, especially, they take this sort of approach to it because if you're in that situation, you don't want to be feeling like, you know, oh, it's the end of the world if I lose. Because at the end of the day, it's not. Obviously, you know, they're competing for high prizes and all that, but at the same time, it's a very friendly community, and people want to see each other and have a good time. So it just makes it the best environment for everyone. And the fact that everyone has this sort of understanding of each other in this way, it just makes it a really great community and game to be a part of.
Really is wonderful. Now, going back to this matchup then, I think, and we saw this in the very first round yesterday, we've seen it a couple of games this weekend. We're sitting at 1-1, and both players have showed us how they are going to win this game. Pedro is going to win by rushing, and Drew is going to win pretty much if he sets up. But we saw a hint at the end of that last game. Maybe there's a situation where Pedro plays an N and Drew doesn't get an energy, or Drew doesn't get a Greninja, or there's one part of that puzzle missing and it just opens up a turn or two, because of course there is every opportunity here that Pedro can one-hit KO these Greninja breaks.
Yeah, absolutely. We see that. So now Pedro's putting out his prizes. Nothing too remarkable. Double Versus Seeker is a little bit of a stinger, but no, there's no Volcanion prize like there was last time.
And we do expect those to be the first. If he takes the order in the usual way, they are the first ones. Of course, what I think is more interesting, his lone Pokemon Ranger is prized. He needs to play that to attack with Volcanion EX two turns in a row. He needs to play that to turn off Shadow Stitching. And we saw, although it was in a losing effort, it was used in a very big turn on the previous game.
The thing about the Pokemon Ranger being prized, though, is that it's very likely that before the Greninja's Shadow Stitchings come into play, that Pedro will have enough time to take enough prizes to actually get that out of there. You see there now, Drew's putting out his prizes as well, and he has one Frogadier prize this time, so it's, again, not the end of the world, but a little bit annoying to, you know, not have access to all four as we kick off game three.
With Pedro playing the world's most pointless escape rope. Oh, that is not a good hand. Well, he's got a Sycamore, I suppose, but that means he's going to be discarding a whole bunch of resources. Max Elixir and two... So that's three energy and a Max Elixir already in the discard pile. Although at least he did get to use one to Steam Up.
I mean, it doesn't really make a difference. He's going first and it's turn one, so it doesn't really make a difference at this point.
No, but it's still nice that he got to use it for... Even though he won't get to do anything, he's still got to use the Steam Up.
But for style points.
Yeah, a couple of style points in play there. It's better than just discarding it, that's all I'm saying.
I guess you're right.
Now, there is one other thing in play here, a very important consideration this game, and that is that we've only got 15 minutes left. So if this game goes on a little bit, there is a chance. Now, as we're in... No, sorry, we're not. We're in the top 32. So if it's a draw, both players will be knocked out of cut. So slightly different point to what I was making. This is still huge. That 15-minute clock is basically a countdown. And if it runs out, a draw here really is a loss for both players. They'll both make top 16. Neither will make top 8. Nothing is gained with a draw here.
Yeah, I mean, it puts the pressure on. And I'm sure that both of these players will be wanting to try and play as fast as they can to try and make sure that doesn't happen.
They will, and I think we will see a faster pace of play going on here because neither player wants to lose. Now, Pedro's got to play at a fast pace anyway because that's his route to winning, but Drew, with his Greninja deck, Greninja is a slower deck. It takes a little bit of time to develop, and that is a slight problem when we're under time constraints. And make no mistake about it, we are very much under time constraints here.
Yeah, as we see there, Pedro is going to... So we've got three of his four volcanoes out now. He's going to bench a Shaman. He's going to draw a couple more cards. He's a float stone off of that. So he probably want to attach that to maybe one of the volcanoes. No, he's going to leave it for now. I guess he doesn't need to retreat straight away. So if he just doesn't need to play it straight away, then there's no reason to do so.
Well, there's always a possibility that that happens.
Yes.
He jumped ahead of my point. If you put a float stone on one Pokemon, your opponent, if they don't have much, can Lysander another, and then you'll really wish you'd save the float stone.
Yep.
Pro move from Pedro here, although it's a little bit mean of Drew to not give me time to finish my point.
Okay. Well, this is why Pedro is sitting there playing this match, and I'm sat behind the commentator desk, obviously.
But now he's got the float stone ready for the Hooper, which means that Drew's dastardly trick has not worked this time. Now, what we really want here, and by we I mean Pedro, non-EX Volcanion, energy, and then one in the hand to steam up, or plus a Fighting Fury belt, or two in the hand to steam up, get the KO on that Froakie nice and early. What Pedro does not want to do is fail to take a KO here, because if Pedro doesn't take a KO, then he's giving Drew one more turn to set up, and that is absolutely not what he wants to do here.
Yeah, we see there he's going to play the Versus Seeker for the Sycamore because he just wants to go in as aggressive as possible and just really try and draw into this Volcanion because it would put him in pretty good stead. We see there one of the cards he discarded is the Salamence EX. We've actually not mentioned that because obviously in this matchup it's not really relevant. It's one of the newest cards we actually have legal currently. It does 10 damage plus 50 more for each EX your opponent has, but this is the one deck which has no EXs in it. So it's really, that's just going to hit the discard pile as soon as it comes up.
But it is still nice, although it's not useful in this matchup. It's a recently released EX card, and actually it's a very, very playable promotional card, and I quite like that. There's something fun about getting a fun promotional card which is actually really, really playable.
Yeah, definitely. So you see there, Trainer's Mail off of that. He's going to grab himself an Energy Retrieval. He got that nice one, the one from Evolutions, like the throwback to the very first artwork of it.
It's fun little artwork. It's not my favourite artwork, but it's fun little artwork. I'm a fan of the base set cards anyway, so anytime I get a chance to, use or see these base set cards, it always makes me that little bit happier.
Yeah, although, going back to in terms of actual gameplay, it doesn't look like... Okay, Pedro does have an Ultra Ball from what it looks like, so he will be able to search out the Volcanion, and with the energy in hand as well, it looks like he will be able to get the attack off, so...
But he needs three energy here. He needs one to attach, and he needs two to steam. Oh, he's got four.
Yeah, with that energy retrieval, he gets two energy back to his hand, and that means he'll definitely have enough energy to be able to get this knockout here. And in fact, he can even afford to discard one of them, and I imagine he'll probably discard Lysander, or maybe the Golden Ultra Ball, maybe. But discarding Lysander makes the most sense, because this means that later on he can access it with Versus Seeker. And Ultra Balling away supporters to discard it, to reuse them with Versus Seeker is especially more important now that Battle Compressor has rotated. It's something that... if you don't do it, you might lose one game on the basis of assuming that you can Versus Seeker or Lysander, but then you play the Versus Seeker and you look for your discard and you realize it's still in your deck.
Oh, yes, and that is a very big point. Versus Seeker is kind of what we call a toolbox card, a card that can do many different things. And here, as long as you've got a supporter in the discard, you can reuse it with Versus Seeker. Now, we've had the energy, we've had the double steam up, so that means Power Heater will hit for 80, KO the Froakie, and Pedro is off. And now Pedro has a very nervous turn here. Oh, no energy for Drew yet. He's going to need to get a basic water energy here to attach to the Frogadier to use water duplicates, because as it is, Pedro is off.
Yeah, splash energy would also work, don't forget. I mean, there's a...
Of course. And of course, the splash energy might even be preferable here. He's got a Froakie on the bench. Did he not get one?
I didn't see one.
Oh, that's not good, Drew.
That's really not. He has got another Frogadier, so if he sees a Water Engine next turn, then he can duplicates. And I think he also had a Super Rod in hand, so it's okay. He can just Super Rod the Froakie and the Frogadier that will inevitably get knocked out back in. It's still not ideal.
This is how Pedro wins a game. He can now use two Power Heaters to do another 80 damage. I'm pretty sure he is, and there are the two energies straight away for the two Power Heaters. No mucking around from Pedro. And He doesn't care that he's taking 6 damage counters and bursting balloon. That is a price he's willing to pay. And all the time, he is attaching energy to his benched Volcanion EX. And as soon as Drew brings out those Greninjas, they are going to be KO'd by the Volcanion EX. One thing I would say, though, 10 minutes left, these players need to play fast.
Yeah, they do. And to be fair, they are. Like, you know, we've seen, you see a lot of players, different paces of play on stream this time, and from what we've seen, I think they're playing at a pretty decent pace.
Oh, no, absolutely. Yeah. I'm not accusing these players of playing slowly by any stretch. I'm just saying that a draw here would be the worst possible case scenario for both of them. So you really do need to go ahead and try and get that win here. So a nice brisk pace of play, you know, being set needs to be maintained by these players because, like I've said, a draw will put them both out of cut. Now, we see the manual attachment there, which means that after this power heater, Pedro is going to have 2 Volcanion EXs, both of which are going to have 3 energy, and that is the magic number.
Yeah, and we saw there that Pedro had the option to play a Max Elixir, but decided not to. And this is very clever, because we already know that he had to discard quite a few energy already. Okay, he's changed his mind. Wait, okay, so, I mean, obviously, you do want more energy on field at the same time, but there could have been an argument there to not play the Max Elixir, given that he's been through so many energy already, so that he has more energy to steam up, to take knockouts with the Power Heater rather than the Volcanic Heat. But I guess at this point, because he's going to be attaching more energy with Power Heater regardless, that he has enough Volcanion EXs to attack with that he doesn't really need the energies in hand to steam up and attack a Power Heater.
And I agree with you entirely on that point. And Pokemon Ranger being prized might hurt. There might be turns here where he's going to really want that Pokemon Ranger so that he can attach in successive turns with the Volcanion EX. And as it is, it's still mired in his prizes.
Yeah, and Drew here, having a look at his... Oh, okay, he has to discard. Obviously, the Faded Town has just come into play, so that's replaced the Skyfield, but it works out nicely for Pedro because he can just discard stuff he doesn't need anymore, like the Shamans. And as I mentioned previously, Drew's now going to, after the knockout, play the Super Rod, put those the Froakie and the Frogadier back into the deck, and I believe I saw Professor Sycamore in his hand, so he should, at this point, more than likely see a Water Energy off of the Sycamore.
We would very much hope so. Oh, Greninja and Greninja break off, discarded off that Sycamore is far from ideal. And he has got the Water Energy, and it is a basic. So has he played? Has he managed to play a Super Rod?
Yeah, but he just played one, and that is his only one in his list as well. So yeah, that actually, that discarding that Greninja and that Greninja break really hurts.
That's what I was going to say, because I thought he had played that Super Rod, which is very much double-edged sword. On the one hand, he's now got 2 Frogadiers, rather than just the one he would have been able to search out. But it means that that Greninja and that Greninja break are not coming back this turn. And
or any turn, for that matter.
Well, indeed, any turn whatsoever. And we assume that Pedro is going to be taking a KO, which means that Drew, he is running out of resources. And this is what we said at the beginning of this game. It's not necessarily rushing to 6 prizes that wins Pedro the game. It's running Drew out of that Greninja line and then, you know, taking a couple of Froakies or whatever to finish out the game, because Drew just can't get those Greninjas rolling.
Yeah, in that sense, you know, Drew is almost doing some of Pedro's work for him by being forced to discard this Greninja and Greninja break. It's just like, I mean, that's what I was going to do anyway. Cheers.
And that energy you talked about with the steam up, Nick, he's still got some energy rolling. We've just seen a double steam up, which means Power Heater will once again hit for 80 damage. He has been able to take 3 prizes in this game, or he soon will have been able to, without putting a Volcanion EX active to take them. That is absolutely huge. He is actually in a position now where he can trade each Volcanion EX for a Greninja and win the prize trade.
It's pretty ludicrous when it gets to that sort of position. I mean, the reason why he was able to do that, of course, he had that first seeker for the Fisherman, which of course lets you take 4 basic energy from your discard pile and put them into your hand. But look at the amount of energy that's actually on Pedro's fuel at this point. Is this every single energy in his deck? It looks like it.
No, it's 10 out of 12.
Okay, so almost.
That's a lot of energy.
Oh, very important there. We've just seen that actually Pedro has taken the Pokemon Ranger out of his prizes just now.
And we've already talked a few times about how crucial that is. And how awesome is this for Pedro? He had that Pokemon Ranger prize. He's sitting there worrying, I need that Ranger. I need to attack on successive turns with the Volcanion EX. I need the Ranger to do so. And then before he even attacks once with Volcanion EX, he draws a ranger out the prizes.
Yeah, that's pretty ideal. I mean, he's going to get end here, so in fact, at this point, end is the same as an ace trainer, so six
it
prizes
is
to
exactly
three.
Exactly the same.
Yeah, but now at least Pedro knows that he has at least a chance of drawing this ranger, and of course, he doesn't even need it this turn because he's going to be able to do one volcanic heat straight away. It's just if he needs to attack with it again twice in a row and isn't able to, you know, retreat by any other means.
Indeed, indeed. Now, Drew here, if he's got an energy, which he does, he can take a prize, and he can take a prize with Shadow Stitching, but that doesn't really do very much, because the problem is, Shadow Stitching turns off those steam ups. Well, Greninja's got 130 HP, Volcanion EX hits for 130, and like I've said, the prize retrade is now unbelievably in Pedro's favour. Drew takes a prize, and then Pedro can take a prize, and then Drew takes two, Pedro takes one, Drew takes two, and then Pedro's going to win with Drew still with one prize left to take, even taking EXs every turn. It is just almost unbelievable that Pedro's managed to get to the stage where he can trade two for one unfavorably and casually win the prize trade.
Yeah, I mean, all credit to Pedro here as well. As we said at the beginning, this is not exactly a favorable matchup for him, but just look at him go. I mean, you know, he got so many energy, he's set up so well, and he's, you know, playing the strategy deck in the right way to try and, you know, beat this unfavorable matchup, and it's just really, really great performance from him.
And I think this is a difference we see, because there's a lot of Volcanion here. We've already shown the metagame analysis on the stream this weekend. We've all seen how many Volcanion decks are being played, quite a few as it turns out. But they're not all here fighting for a spot in top 8. And sometimes it's players like Pedro who have the list, who have the right list, who set up. And when your deck can do this against an unfavorable matchup, and we assume now squeak out a win, you must be feeling good. Now, if I'm Pedro here, I'm tempted. Has he got a Versus Seeker in hand?
He does.
Because I'd be tempted to just Versus Seeker the Fisherman and Power Heater for the KO, just like he's done the last turn.
I think that'd be very... Yeah, I think that's probably the best play he can do. And not only that, but he actually redrew the Ranger off of the end as well. Not that, again, if he attacks a Power Heater, not that it's going to matter, but... Yeah, he can just Versus Seeker for... Wait, actually, no, you can't Versus Seeker for Fisherman because I think he has any Fire Energy in his discard pile.
Oh, he's been recovering them all with Power Heat, and that's what he's looking for. So actually, Power Heater has been so powerful, it's turned off the option of Fisherman.
Yeah, it has. And this is what I was trying to allude to earlier with like all the energy being on the field, that he wouldn't be able to steam up. But, I mean, at the same time, he's attached two energies to this active Volcanion, so he can just retreat manually and then attack Volcanic Heat. So it's still fine.
And that is absolutely where that came from. And let's not forget that once he retreats to that Volcanion, oh, now he happens to have that energy in the discard. So Versus Seeker for Fisherman becomes a nice, valid play. And I think he might have even drawn a Versus Seeker off of that Sycamore anyway.
Yeah, which is good because it means that he'll have access to... He obviously just discarded a Pokemon Ranger off of that Professor Sycamore. So that means that Versus Seeker can become Ranger and he can Volcanic Heat twice in a row if he wants to.
Now, here's an interesting one. He's actually drawn an energy retrieval off of his Sycamore. So one option he would have here is to manually retreat the active non-EX Volcanion, promote the bench non-EX Volcanion, energy retrieval the two energy he discarded retreating, then double steam up and KO with Power Heater.
That would be pretty good.
It's a bit convoluted, but assuming I saw an energy retrieval in his hand, and I think I did, that is a play which is open to him.
Yeah, another thing he could do is he has an escape rope. So he could use that to try and actually deal with the Greninja now. He'll take 60 from the Bursting Balloon, but I actually think that's fine because in terms of what it does in putting Drew behind on board position, it might actually just be the best thing to do.
No, here he's got an even better play. Retreat, escape rope,
yep,
and then
there we go.
KO the Greninja. Now, I think actually there was a... Was there not a Shadow Stitching last turn? So Steam Up was actually turned off this turn?
No, it wasn't. What Drew did was just retreat his Greninja into the Frogadier and pass.
Oh, of course he did. The Shadow Stitching was the previous turn. Yes, I get that. Okay. No, that's good. That's good. So I personally would have liked to have seen the KO on the Frogadier, but it doesn't really matter. We are quibbling over details at this stage. Pedro has got the KO. He's going down to two prizes. He's attacking into a Bursting Balloon. And that's the one thing which I don't like quite so much about this play, because it means that if Drew has a Greninja and a Water Energy, he then gets the KO.
Well, Drew will have the Greninja because, of course, that Splash Energy means that Greninja will go back into his hand. But yeah, the question is, does he have the... Well, even then, I guess he had the Froakie as well, so he can bench that. And yeah, he can evolve into Greninja. He can attack the Volcanion. But then Petra just KOs him right back. And then at that point, Drew's left with a Froakie.
And that was going to be the end to my points there. Because, okay, doesn't really matter. Whichever order he KOs them, they're the next two KOs.
And see, interesting, Drew opted not to, and we are in overtime now, I guess. Drew opted not to bench the Froakie that he got off of that splash energy, unless, oh no, it might have been from a Frogadier that was water duplicates. So
I believe that was the case. Now, Drew here, I mean, he's going to want to get the breakout at some point, and then maybe Shadow Stick. I mean, I don't think there's anything Drew can do here.
Okay, he has drawn a Froakie, so he can bench that just to give himself the chance to maybe bubble for the tie instead of, you know, losing. But yeah, and I didn't even see if he drew an energy. He has a dive ball, but he's going to get another Froakie off of that. But it doesn't really make a difference in that sort of sense, because in fact, if anything, that could... I don't know. Petra only needs to take two knockouts. That's the big problem here. So
and even he's only got two turns. So your bubble point, I love your bubble point, Nick, because a single heads on a bubble with no way to switch guarantees the tie.
Yeah, and we'll have to see if that's what Drew decides to go for.
If he does bubble, now I've seen something in Pedro's hand. He's got a Versus Seeker. Is the Olympia in his discard? Because that is, I know it's not in the prizes, because if Olympia's in the discard, then he can use Olympia to switch out of the paralysis, and he'll be fine. Look at that, just casually throwing away free energy to retreat. Why not? Of course, he's got free energy on the non-EX Volcanion, which should be enough to KO a Froakie or a Frogadier.
Yeah,
is he going to go bubble?
He's going to have to. Like, this is it. This is turn two of time now. Here comes water energy, and a huge, huge coin flip here. He's going
to
play...
Oh, he's going to end him to one!
Well, yeah, I mean, he would not do that if you have the option to. But it doesn't make too much of a difference, because what the option... I guess it makes it so that Pedro's less likely to have the Olympia, but...
He's not. He's Lysander.
Oh.
So that he's got to have the Olympia so that a float stone wouldn't have worked anyway because of the Fighting Fury bout. I would have liked to have seen the... Well, I suppose bubble, but then tails and you lose instantly anyway. Yeah. So I see where he's going with this. He wants to play this game out. He's
like hedging his odds, I guess. But
It's
heads, but... Does Pedro have the Versus Seeker for the Olympia?
He's got the Versus Seeker, but I don't know if the Olympia's in his discard. If it is, he wins the game right here. There's the Versus Seeker.
I'm fairly sure it is. I'm fairly sure we saw it.
Olympia will win him the game.
There it is!
There's the Olympia. He gets into the top eight of the Pokemon trading card game. International championships. Congratulations to Pedro. Booking his ticket in the top eight. That was a very exciting end. And considering we saw we had a Greninja against a Volcanion, I was not expecting to be holding my breath to see what was drawn on the final turn of time.
What an incredible demonstration from Pedro. He's got doing Spain absolutely proud. You can hear the Spanish crowd going absolutely crazy out there. They are so happy, and rightfully so. Congratulations, Pedro. You're a very deserving winner.
And that was the very last turn of time. we talked about Olympia a little bit earlier, and shall we say, I'm pretty sure Pedro's glad he's playing Olympia right about now.
Yeah,
that was absolutely brilliant. Well, you've got to commiserate for Drew. He was, you know, two long days of competition, and played so well, had such a good record, and then coming into the last round against a matchup which should be favourable, and just not quite enough to get the win.
Yeah, but what are you going to do? I mean, you know, anything can happen in Pokemon, and it usually does. I think that's the best way we can summarize what happened there. Just an incredible match to watch. It's been an absolute pleasure to watch over all of that. And yeah, again, just a huge well done to Pedro, overcoming, like I said, an unfavorable matchup and just playing superbly and just having the means of being able to overcome that difficulty and do Spain proud.
It's one of those games where you go and see your friends and your friends are like, oh, what are you playing? Because it's your winning in. You win your into bait. What are you playing against? And you tell them you're playing against Greninja and they're all like, ah, top 16 still good.